So, computational advertising at scale. First off, my name is Suju Rajan. I'm the SVP of the Criteo AI Lab, and I lead a research and engineering team towards putting in state-of-the-art machine learning solutions at Criteo. And before I begin, thank you all for making the time to come out here. I know everybody has a very busy life, but it's nice to see everyone come together, and we will make sure that by the end of this evening, you at least have some appreciation for the machine learning challenges in computational advertising. At least that's the goal. So before we get started, some of you already knew Criteo, so perhaps you know the space, but let's just level the vocabulary a little bit. So what is the problem that we are trying to solve? At the center of everything is a user, people like you and me, right? That different entities are trying to reach. In this case, another second player is going to be what we call an advertiser. And you can use Macy's or Best Buy or Walmart as an example of an advertiser. In some contexts, it could be a brand like Nike. And these are the folks who are trying to reach the user to get them to be aware of some of the products that they are selling. Okay, so Criteo, for the most part, works with the retailers of the world. Now, the question is, since several years, decades even, how has advertising worked? It has always been by placing the ads in front of what the user spent most of their time on. So in today's world, what is that? It's what we are calling publishers. And maybe it's useful for us to look at that graph on your right, where you can see that the amount of time that the adult users in the US spend online has been growing quite a bit. I don't know what it says about us as a species when we spend 6 hours in front of some sort of a device, but that's where we are spending most of our time, right? So now the advertiser wants to reach this user, and what are they going to do then? They want to place the ads in the publisher site. So what do we mean by a publisher site? This could be your typical blogs, it could be the news portals that you go to, or it could even be a social media platform. So I'm just using an umbrella term publisher to talk about all of these folks. Yeah? So the advertisers now work with the publishers to place an ad, and therefore the user interacts via the publisher and gets to know about the advertiser and the products that the advertiser sells. Now, what is Criteo's role in all of this? So if you look, this is from Life Stats, so the number of users online at any given instance is 3.9 billion, and we have close to 2 billion websites. Of course, a lot of it perhaps are sites that never get visited. But the problem that the advertiser is trying to solve is what publishers should they work with to be able to reach the users who'd be interested in the products that this advertiser sells. Now, this is where Criteo comes in to help solve this large-scale problem, right? So basically, if I am, say, Best Buy, I need not know about all of the thousands or billions of different sites and figure out which sites do I need to place my ads on. I'm more interested in, coming up with an inventory of good electronic goods and whatnot. And Criteo is going to help Best Buy reach the users that Best Buy is interested in, okay, as an example. So a little bit of context. We were founded in 2005 and have grown significantly since. At the core of everything that we do are our shoppers, are our users. These are the folks who are interested in the goods that are being sold by our retailers, and we work with more than 18,000 retailers. We work with more than 1,000 brands, and we have a lot of partnerships with many different publishers of the world. Now, through Criteo, we actually see $600 billion of annual sales. So that gives you a sense for the scale of the data that we are talking about. And in all of this, it's important to realize that Criteo is acting on behalf of the retailers, right? These are whom we are calling partners, the Best Buys and the Walmarts of the world. So they come to Criteo and say, hey, Criteo, help me figure out how can I reach the users who are interested in the goods that I'm going to sell, okay? Now, how does this look like in action, right? So kind of a dated article, but imagine you are reading this and Washington Post, the publisher, needs to make money. So they have a couple of slots in which they could possibly show ads to the users, right? So now the question is, how do we decide what is the ad that needs to be shown in the slot? In this case, the user was me, and this was the ad that it was shown. Now, how do we get to this point from having a slot available for a specific user on a specific site to deciding what goes there is, in general, the problem of online advertising, okay? Now, what makes Criteo good at this problem is, as I mentioned, our partnership with all of our retailers. Therefore, we get a lot of information about the products that are being sold by the retailers. What are the different behaviors that the users do on these retailer sites? So we have access to a lot of unique client data. And another thing that we gather as well is how do these users behave on the different publisher sites? As I mentioned, there are 2 billion different websites on the world. Now, not all of them are created equal, so it doesn't make sense for you to show ads on sites that are possibly, what can I say, fake news or some such thing. So how do we figure out where do we want to place the ad, what will be the format that works, and so on and so forth. Now, feeding all of this data to figure out the most performant way of showing an ad. As Clem mentioned, machine learning has always been at the core of what Criteo does. Now, and that is showing up very badly, which wasn't the case before. So I'll just tell you that to construct an ad, then we need to have 4 main machine learning problems that we are going to solve. One is to make sense of all of the user data that we get. So we are able to build some sort of what we call a unique profile for a user across many different devices so that the context is relevant regardless of where the user shows up. Then the second problem is what we are calling the bidding problem. And this is to figure out how much do I want to pay for the right to show an ad on Washington Post. The third problem is recommendation. Once I won that particular slot, I want to figure out what is the product that I want to show there. And finally, what is the look and feel of the banner itself? Okay, I'm just laughing because people are taking pictures of the slide. Hopefully it doesn't go down as, hey, here's the worst slide in Women in ML Talk. Okay, so once we have all of this, then it just cranks through multiple machine learning models to figure out what works. So in my talk, I'm just going to talk about one of the layers, which is the predictive bidding aspect of it. The speakers after me, Feng Zhao and Diane, will get into some of the other problems. So let's talk about the predictive bidding aspect. Again, to make this more concrete, a user, say I show up on my device on a publisher site, which is the Post, and there is a possibility of showing an ad on the Post. Now, what the Post does is that it doesn't go out and talk to every different advertiser of the world. It goes through something that is called an ad exchange. You might have heard of the term double click. This is an ad exchange that is run by Google as an example. So they put that particular slot up for auction on an ad exchange. And there are several players who want to bid on that particular slot, right? So some examples are, of course, Google, Amazon, and Criteo, okay? Now, my specific problem at Criteo is how do I figure out how much do I want to bid, meaning what is the price I want to pay for this particular slot to the ad exchange. Now, this needs to factor in a lot of different things. Of course, there is profit to be made at all of those different cycles. And of course, at the end of the day, you don't want the user to get annoyed with you. So how do you construct a bid that makes the most sense? Okay. Just to give you guys a sense for the numbers, if you think of the number of comments that show up at Facebook any given day, it's close to 166 million. 500 million tweets per day, 3.5 billion searches a day. Criteo fields 200 billion display requests a day. That means we get called 200 billion times a day. So why is this the case? Think of the number of users showing up in many, many different sites. Each of these sites have an option to show an ad, and we need to decide if you're going to bid on that particular slot or not. And Criteo feels 200 billion, just to give you a sense for the scale that we are talking about. Okay? Now, how do we turn that into a machine learning problem? So basically, we want to say that the bid is some function of what I'm simplifying into, what is the probability of action, into what is the value that I'm going to get out of that particular action. Now, what are examples of actions? It could be the fact that it's an impression, meaning that the user just saw an ad. It could be a click, or it could be what we call conversion. In ad terminology, it's the fact that an actual sale has happened on that site. Okay? And the action value is, of course, mostly going to be how much is the revenue that you're going to get from that particular action, right? As an advertiser, say if I'm Best Buy, I'm not possibly interested in users just clicking on an ad. I'm also expecting to make a sale, right? That's the whole point of advertising. There's also a concept of incremental sales, meaning if I was anyways going to buy a phone, then showing me the ad is pointless, right? What matters is what did the ad make me buy that I was not ready to buy. And that's what we are calling incremental sales out here. And the reason that we have many different values for this is we have many different business models, as we call it. Some clients, maybe Best Buy says, hey, I'm just interested in driving traffic to my sites, so just optimize for impressions. Someone might say optimize for sales and so on and so forth. So these things can take on many different values. Now, for the sake of simplicity, let's say we are just going to talk about what is the probability of click given the display. This is otherwise called CTR, or the click-through rate, which is the most, commonly used term. And say that the action value we are interested in is what is the sales that we are going to get out of it. Okay? Now, a step further, and this is a pipeline most of you are going to be familiar with. So the very first question we have to ask ourselves is, what are the sources of data that we can use to solve this particular problem, right? And as I mentioned earlier, Criteo has quite a bit of interesting data that comes from many different sources. And since we are partnering with our clients, if you will, the Walmarts and the Best Buys of the world, we have a good handle on what are the products that are being sold, what are the categories this product falls in, what is the price range. So we are able to make, let's say, fine-grained understanding of the product space itself. Feng Zhao will talk about one of those problems related to it. The second thing that we have access to is what we call advertiser site events. This is how do these users behave on the sites, right? So did a user just show up, look at the homepage and go away? Did they click on a specific product? Did they add it to their cart? And so on and so forth. So this is what we call advertiser site events. And then, as mentioned earlier, we also have a whole bunch of publisher site information, meaning, okay, is it useful for me to show an ad on the post? If so, what is the format that works? And so on and so forth. And of course, now you need to personalize it for all of the users that we see. So it's 1.4 billion users. Now, imagine encoding all of this data into some sort of a feature space, right? So maybe the simplest thing is to say, let's just throw the whole lot into a simple one-hot encoding problem, where I'm just going to use single instances of everything that happened. Maybe you add in a few crosses, but as you can easily see, the scale that we are talking about is several billions, right? So the feature space is just going to explode. So one thing that works quite well in these contexts is, of course, the hashing trick, where you're going to say, hey, instead of considering the billion space, I'm going to try to hash all of these features into a much smaller space. And of course, you lose some signal, but you are able to capture when you want to weight some aspects of the features more than the others. Now, is that sufficient? And here I'm going to take a slight tangent into one of the research problems that we considered. For those of you who are interested, this was inspired by the work that came out of Zalando, but there's a pointer to the paper from Criteo as well. But what is the problem that we are trying to solve? So if you look at how users purchase data, purchase items, there is some sort of a linearity to it, right? The fact that, a personal example, I guess, once you have a child, you go through this whole notion of buying different products that you didn't even know exist, I guess is the case. But imagine trying to handcraft features saying that, hey, I want to say that the number of product views has to be between 6 and 10. I'll learn a weight for that. The number of shopping sessions that I see, when was the last session? It requires a whole bunch of intuition to come up with this sort of features to encode what is a natural sequence that you observe in the data. So the idea is to say, hey, can we just use the timeline information to say, here are the different events that I am observing. Here is the time interval that I'm seeing it in. Here is the context in which I'm observing it. And can we use that sort of a embedding information as a feature in my model? So that's exactly what we tried to do. And this is the pointer to the work that came out of our research team itself. It was specifically an LSTM with a gated recurrent unit that was used. But the difference here is we wanted to add what we are calling the context information to be able to make a prediction. So the difference from a classical unit that you see is not only do you have the input vector, but you also have what we are calling the context, where the context could be something like, hey, was this a view? Was it an add to a shopping cart or some other specific action that the user did? What was the time at which this happened and so on and so forth? So you want to learn to embed that. And of course, then you go through the classical problem of here is the previous state. I'm going to predict what the next state is going to be for the current context, which is different, of course. And then you have a typical softmax function on top of it. Now, the experimental results are in the paper as well. One cool thing about Criteo is we have a lot of data to play with. So we had 32 million training instances, and this is really sequences of shopping behavior. And we were able to create a fairly large size data set. And the problem that we are trying to see is what is the probability that a sale is going to occur in 24 hours. Now you can imagine that if you're going to model the fact that a sale is going to occur, obviously a click has to happen, but you want to bid a lot higher on those clicks in which you expect a sale to happen as well. Okay, so that's what we did. The metric is negative log likelihood. So obviously the lower it is on that graph, the better it is. And the x-axis is the number of events that we are seeing in our timelines. So obviously, the more events that you have, meaning the longer the timelines, the better you're able to capture that particular information. Okay? So that was a slight segue. Now, coming back to our problem again. So we said we wanted to estimate CTR. But this is a highly, highly imbalanced data set. And just to give you an example, out of the 10,000 displays, we possibly get 50 clicks on our ads, and finally we get just one sale, right? So imagine the skewness, but more importantly, the part that I wanted to talk about was target representation, right? What do you want to learn as the output label? And I mentioned to you guys that maybe it is clicks, sometimes it's sales, sometimes it could be impressions and so on and so forth. But imagine if what I want to learn is the probability of sale. Now, the graph over there shows that, okay, so it's a cumulative distribution. The x-axis is the number of days it takes before a sale happens. Okay, so you can see that for 40% of our clicks, if you will, the sale happens after 5 days. Now, why does this matter? Imagine I'm training a machine learning model in which my label is going to be the sale. I literally need to wait for 5 days for 40% of my data to find out if I need to set the label to be a 1 or a 0. Now, there is a trade-off to be made here. Since we are talking about predicting how quickly the users are going to react, if I wait too long, now my data is too old, right? So it's not going to be able to catch up fast enough. So the window can't be too short or too long. So one of the neat tricks that we did, again, here's the pointer to the paper on it, was to use something that we called modeling the delayed feedback. Knowing that you're going to have a sale that is going to be delayed, how can you work that into your problem itself? So it was solved very nicely at the joint optimization problem, where you want to say not only that are you going to see here C is a conversion, not a click, given that particular context, but at the same time, you also want to model the fact that you're going to see a delay in that click happening itself. So sort of working both of these factors in helps you sort of adjust for the fact that you do not know some of the labels. So you're going to use an estimate for the fact that, hey, a click could happen if the delay is at this point versus something else. Okay? So that's hopefully another way of thinking about the problem. Okay, so coming back, modeling the CTR prediction. So we took a couple of segues. Hopefully you saw that the feature space itself gives you a rich space for thinking about different sorts of machine learning problems in which you can approach it. Then we have what is a hugely imbalanced data set. And finally, it comes down to what sort of a model do we want to learn. So simplest one is, of course, your logistic regression model. But as mentioned earlier, then that requires you to have a lot of careful thought and insight into what sort of features do you want to add to that model. But to be transparent, of course, it's a hard model to beat because it's the simplest and makes the least assumptions about the data. So we tried to challenge that a little bit more and pointed to another paper, which is the field-aware factorization machine. And for those of you who may not be aware of it, it follows very much along the lines of factorization machines. We're given a whole bunch of feature dimensions. You're trying to learn a latent representation for it. But unlike factorization machines, what you're trying to do is to learn several different latent representations for a feature, but you want to trigger only one of those, depending upon the context in which it occurs. Again, I'll make a plug for the blog post that we have on our site, which explains that with a much cleaner example, so you'll be able to get the intuition behind it. But the neat part about this is it captures interactions between the features of the data much nicer than how much I can do as a human thinking about, hey, I need to add these two things together and so on and so forth. So we managed to see good improvements both offline and online. But this is a non-convex problem, so it's not, you need to try it many, many different times with many initializations to be sure that you're getting a solution that actually has converged. Unfortunately, it's not something that could be deployed simply because the size of the model and the amount of latency that it introduces at inference time for us was too high. Yeah, but it was a good research angle to think about and see, hey, how do you cast this particular problem? So I want to sort of end with some of the practicalities that we have, which I didn't touch upon. And one aspect of it is how do we want to treat our data? And as you can see, there is quite a bit of bias that comes in, as in the fact that a sale happens is conditioned on the fact that a click happened, which is conditioned on the fact that a display was actually made, conditioned on the fact that we actually won that auction. Now, there is this whole space that we are not able to model because we did not win the auction or someone did not click or whatnot. So you kind of need to be very careful about how you treat the training data itself. You cannot just say, hey, just because a click happens, it's positive and that's it. You need to account for the fact that the reason that the click happened depended on so many other factors before it. Okay? And another problem that we deal with is what we called reactivity. As you can imagine, user interest in products go up during certain specific times, of course, during holidays and so on and so forth. Imagine it's a brand new iPhone, for lack of my imagination, and lots of people are interested in it and so on and so forth. So in those cases, we need to have models which can deal very quickly with non-stationarity in the data. Okay? And to give you a sense for the scale of the model training, we pretty much get tens of terabytes of data every day. The model itself is trained on hundreds of terabytes any single instance. 1,300 different models because we have many different campaigns. And I kind of mentioned many different business models that we have to talk about in the sense that and maybe some of our clients are interested in conversions, some of them are interested in clicks, but at any given point, we need to be able to make a bid for any of our clients. Okay? And the refresh period, meaning that how frequently do we keep retraining these models, is somewhere between 3 to 6 hours. But the biggest challenge for us is what we call real-time inference. At the end of the day, I need to have this model running in a real-world server where I have less than 10 milliseconds to return a bid. Okay? Because imagine the ecosystem that happens here. So post comes in, then it sends this request to the ad exchange. The ad exchange fields it out to a whole bunch of different players. They all need to return with a bid, and then the ad exchange responds with who won that particular bid. And all of this has to happen before the user gets annoyed by waiting for the page to load. So the time that you have to react to any given bid request is really, really small. So coming up with, I don't know, fancy LSTM, if I may, or CNN, or one of these newer architectures, which take a lot more time to make an inference, simply doesn't work. Maybe with the newer models of TPUs and whatnot, it will. But again, at the scale that we want it to work, it's questionable. OK, so to conclude, we touched upon just one problem. How much do we bid for this particular slot? But that was barely one of the questions we have to answer. As I mentioned, we also need to make sure that our clients might have some other goals of saying, hey, I want to be able to reach so many users within a given period. Now, not only can I bid my true estimated value, but I also need to bid enough to make sure that I'm actually winning the auction. And it's a completely different talk, but it's interesting to know that in a world where everything, for those of you who are interested in auction theory, you want to believe that second price auction, meaning you pay the second highest price, is the way you should run the world, but everyone's greedy. So it's not always a second price auction, so you need to be able to respond to the fact that the publishers may not be running a second price auction. So how can we bid? So not only do we have a good shot at winning the auction, but we also need to be aligned with the advertiser view. And just to give you sense of what I mean by that. Criteo is not the only channel that Best Buy is going to be advertising with, right? So they might be advertising online, they might be advertising through, I don't know, TV, radio, spots, and whatnot. Now, you need to be able to treat your target label only for those things that Best Buy thinks Criteo influenced. Do you see what I mean? So if Best Buy feels that, hey, Erin converted because she saw a TV ad and not because Criteo showed an ad, I need to take that feedback into account into my model so I don't give too much credit for the fact that she might have clicked on my ad, but that's not what caused her to convert. So we really need to be aligned with the view on the advertiser itself and, of course, be immune to malicious attacks. We, of course, don't want bots clicking on our ads. We do not want our ads showing up in fake news sites and so on and so forth. So I touched upon just one of those questions, but for those of you who are interested, I can point you to more literature on it. Now, once we won that slot, of course, now we need to decide what we want to show on that slot, which is what Diane will be talking about next. So I will conclude with that, with a plugin for our site. We have a blog where our researchers write about all of the work that they're doing. You can also follow us on Twitter. We tweet about all the papers and much more interesting stuff that happens in AI Lab as well. So with that, I'll conclude, and thank you all for your attention.